this meeting is being broadcast and recorded, and it's 6:30.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The agenda for tonight's meeting is in your packets, and I'd like to extend a welcome to Tom Nephew, who is the newest member of the Board of Public Works. Tom, as you know, was appointed Monday night, a joint appointment between the Board of Selectmen and the Board of Public Works to fill the remainder of the term created by the vacancy from last year's election. And he has indicated that he intends to file nomination papers and has them tonight. So I'd like to run for the remaining years of the term, and congratulations and welcome.
Thank you.
First order of business is acceptance of the minutes of the December 22nd, the regular board meeting. They're in your packets for review. I would ask that you take a look, note any corrections, and vote to approve.
2 punctuation marks.
Go for it.
It's tough.
Sorry.
No, it's
under meter replacement program, last word of the 5th line. It's Towns is not, it's Towns, like, it's apostrophe S, correct?
Oh.
And then under miscellaneous updates, 3rd bullet, it's Wright hyphen Pierce.
Oh, no. No trademark or reserve or copyright or any other?
No.
Okay.
And I was surprised to see the word cajole in the minutes, because that is not a meeting minutes word, but it's appropriate. So other than that, I'm good.
And the meeting dates have changed.
They have, but those were...
They were fine at the end of the meeting, is what's here.
I make a motion we accept the meeting minutes of the December 22nd, 2016 meeting as amended.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Tom can't vote on that.
Right. Not yet.
He wasn't.
Next
true.
Meeting.
That's true.
You were here, but you were not a member. Okay.
Taken it away from you.
Even if you mean it personally, I won't.
You got a lot of motions to make and seconds to make, so... Yeah. Just get used to it.
That's your first abstain. There you go.
First and last.
Answer for that. He wasn't a member at that time. Okay, next item on the agenda is the abatements. There are 3 requests before the board tonight, including 1 an administrative request that is 1 of 2 requests for the same property. So hopefully it doesn't get too confusing. So let's start with the first one, which is the administrative appeal for 25 Heal Street. There was a bad reading attributed to a faulty Firefly, which is the remote reading devices that we're replacing. And so the staff had recommended to abate all of the October charges for water and for sewer, and that just to rebuild the account in November, which they did.
Okay.
So I would ask that the board abate 104.27 in water and 201.68 in sewer.
You said this is related to another one.
The next one coming up.
Is it the same meet count number and meter?
These billings carrying on November will be on the next abatement totals. So this kind of clears the slate. The November bill is issued, and that's the one that's currently.
If we shouldn't be abating the amounts in our Duke.
2 different billing periods?
Well, I just want to make sure that should we be looking at them separately, or is it?
No,
I'm just trying to understand that.
This is basically the Firefly. So they went back and they did the rereads, corroborated the rereads, which incorporated the October billing. So if we don't want to double bill for the October.
No, I understand. But if the problem, whatever occurred after the.
No.
Okay. All right. I just want to make sure that they're.
No,
they
it, it occurred before that.
Okay. All right. I make a motion to abate the account 821 for 25 Heald Street in the amount of $104.27 water and $201.68 sewer.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Who was seconded?
Bill.
Bill. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And the second one pertaining to that property. The customer is requesting an unspecified abatement total for the excess use that is being attributed to a disgruntled tenant's water use. A letter explaining that situation is included in your packet. as is the superintendent's recommendation and the sample calculations that were based on the typical relief scenarios that the board typically adopts. One note is compounding the typical allowance made for the sewer consumption in these cases is the fact that this particular property is billed as a duplex, and therefore the thresholds for the tiers are doubled, and that effectively diminishes, eliminates the sewer consumption from the typical consideration that the board would use. So keep that in mind in your deliberations.
So it's single meter serving two properties, right. Two residences.
Correct. Okay. And so it's, as you know, that the basically all we do is just double the quantities at the tiers.
Now, is this, with the reread, is this now a seven-month bill?
Correct.
And not a six-month bill?
Actually, I shouldn't say it. That's my understanding. I had the date.
That's why I was asking about the other one.
It must be because I think it's the December 20, what's the due date on the second bill? It was a... due yes. dates, yeah, 11/21, so it does incorporate three quarters of November's on there.
Okay, so it's pretty close to a 7 month, because that, I think that needs to be in the thought process as well when we're looking at past usages, yep. That if we were to be.
And the Blagdens are here tonight to present their case to the board. The floor is yours.
Oh, we were just here to answer questions of what
law. Well, if you want to take a second and read the letter, I mean, explanatory.
I really put it all in the letter. And the only thing I would add to that letter is we did have our meters replaced, and it was 32 days ago. And I note in my letter here, when I did 25 days of watching my meter, I came up with about 12 cubic feet per day. Then we had our meters changed out, and I went and I read the meter today. So for the last 32 days, I'm still averaging 12 cubic feet per day. So we eliminated the meter problem, we eliminated the leak problem, but we still had this massive spike that occurred. So that's all I would add to what's in the letter.
Okay. Good to hear that the new meter verified the old meter.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
They didn't have a swimming pool.
No. So this is the first time you did deduct meter. This is the first bill that you ever
had. Yeah, we had the meter put in May. So we could see that, you know, that the spike was on the main meter.
The tenants unit occupied pretty much consistently over the last
the
5 years.
The tenant was the only one in the house. It's a two-family home, but it's our the other apartment isn't rented.
Isn't really a functional apartment.
We had set it aside for our daughter, so if she wanted to come and visit, she could be in here.
Okay.
But she doesn't do that. Right. She loves us, but she doesn't stay in the apartment.
But the building has been, I guess, this water meter serves just that building.
Yes.
And it's been occupied
yes.
fairly consistently.
Yes.
Is the tenant that just left, were they fairly consistent?
They were there for 2 years.
For 2 years. Okay.
And there's no chance to recover this from a security deposit or anything like that?
We didn't have,
a security deposit.
Okay.
It would have gone to other things anyway, so...
small claims, but all right, so I know Joe's not here. I gotta figure out his little spreadsheet here.
Well, again, on the water side, you know, basically he's billed the excess at the lowest tier, which in the case of water, the second tier is a different rate. Compounding the fact that it's a, you know, the duplex, the tier is double, but as you know, the also the first and second tier are actually at the same rate.
Right.
But it's, you know, under the typical scenario of taking the average usage, billing usage at the average excess from the average at the lowest tier would result in a 229.31 deduction on water. But again, because of the sewer.
So the sewer didn't trip?
Correct.
Because it's a
double
it's
here.
A duplex.
Right.
Okay.
But with that being said, I think you did have a similar case, or not a similar case, another case where you took a, I won't say arbitrary, but you came out with what you thought was a fair and equitable adjustment for the bill.
No, I do recall that one. I don't know if it's the same circumstance.
It's not the same circumstance.
Yes. No, I know we can,
these scenarios are just that, advisory.
Yeah. In this case, the water did go down the bill. If the scenario you envision happened that way, correct?
Well, we had the deduct meter on there, so we knew it didn't go outside.
So it went through the meter and out the sewer.
Yeah, honestly, the last summer period wasn't that much lower.
That's a little bit of what makes us think that might be what happened, is that if during that period we asked them, you know, what's going on, the bill is so much higher, and it turned out the toilet was running. And so we fixed that as soon as we found out that that was true. But it also made them very aware of how quickly and easily the water bill can be a hardship.
Mm.
So it's a little bit of, actually, I think it was Trish who said something about it. It was like, you know, that rings true.
Oh, yeah. No, we've had people come in and, you know, for a few days, you can use a lot of water.
Well, that's what we think. It was probably that 10-day period after they were told they had to leave the house. After, you know, and we had given them 11 months notice.
Yeah, people don't get it.
We tried not to be unfair.
It's unfortunate.
Isn't it fun being a landlord?
I guess I'm not quite seeing a solution on the sewer side. Simply, I don't know if you have any ideas, Bill, or thoughts.
Yeah, I'm inclined to go with the water abatement that's shown here, the low, running, you know, running the calculation to lowest
right.
tier. But it still did go down the sewer. It's not a case where the water was lost to a leak or something like that. So we're still treating the water.
Right. No, This is assuming everything's on a 6 month basis, where this is a 7 month basis, so it's a little
it's going to be
higher,
a little bit higher than
it would be a little
usual.
Bit higher than it normally would be. So yeah, it's unfortunate.
your thoughts?
Me?
I'm kind of agreeing with you guys.
All right. Fortunately, it's not as, we try to be as accommodating as possible. You're just kind of, the position that you're sitting in where it's a duplex, you know, this, our policy is our policy. We can't take it away. We can bill you at the lowest rate. The lowest rate for sewer is where you're at already, given that it's a duplex situation. You know, hopefully your next tenant or...
Actually, we live there now.
So the duplex situation, though, so it isn't actually a duplex, but you're using a duplex...
Well, it is by our tax.
By our tax, okay.
Right.
The fact that it's on the books as that is the only fact that you need to have, whether it is or is not.
We have to, like, two separate properties that are being serviced by one meter. So we have to assume that two families can be in it and using the water. So when we look at it, we have to divide everything up to say, okay, this is going across the two separate properties, regardless of whether they're occupied or not, because that's just the way the situation works and the billing process works.
And quite honestly, from a water perspective, having an unoccupied half of a duplex works out to the homeowner's advantage in that your thresholds before you trip the second tier are so much higher, you'd almost never trip them as a single family in a duplex.
We are in the process of reviewing the rate structures and such, so we don't know where we'll end up, but this is what we have right now. So I make a motion that we abate the account 821 27 Heald Street in the amount of $229.31 water and $0 sewer.
Heald or 27 Jewett?
Heald.
The house is on Heald. We just lived at 27 Jewett up until September. We moved to 27 Heald.
That's true. Right. The bill says 27 Jewett on it. Yeah, that's the mailing address.
The mailing address.
Service address is 25 Heald.
Correct.
Yeah, 27 Heald. 25 is a lot.
No, but I think our bill still reads 25 Heald.
Count number 821.
Let's go with that one.
That's good.
Put the rest.
229.31, you said?
Yes, I did.
Second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'm going to have to fill that. My pen's not doing it.
Okay, when Trish comes back, she'll be in touch.
Yeah, she told me she would be.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for your time and consideration. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
You too.
And if you'd like, we can take a minute probably after, and I can walk you through these sample calculations.
That would be good. I didn't want to bog the meeting down.
That's okay. Next item, one is Jewett Street.
Okay.
113 Jewett Street. The customer is requesting an abatement for excess water consumption that's attributed to a leaking exterior silcock. There's a letter explaining the situation in your packets, as is the superintendent's recommendations and sample calculations based on typical relief scenarios. And Ms. Halloran, I assume,
yes,
is here tonight to present her case. And the floor is yours.
Okay. Well, basically what happened is we got the water bill, and it was exponentially bigger than what we had ever seen in our water bill. So I called, I ended up talking to Trish. She kind of walked me through the process of trying to find a leak, went through the house, checked the toilets, checked the spigots, and found that it was actually a twofold problem that happened with the water. The shutoff inside the basement had failed, and then so I guess that had basically just the water, the outside spigot had then failed too. So that was dripping, and it was such a slight drip, it wasn't even dripping, it was just when I put my hand on it, that's when I actually found the leak. So I think it had been leaking for, you know, the period of the bill, and then we just never knew it was leaking. I guess that was the biggest thing. And then as soon as we found the leak, we fixed it, he replaced the shutoff valve in the house. That I capped the spigot outside immediately, then we replaced the shutoff valve that weekend. And so now it's not leaking anymore. We're looking for some relief because it was just really high bill, and it's taxing on us to pay something that, and we work very hard to upkeep our house.
You said you've been in town you're almost all the use on this bill. You are all the use on this bill. Your summer periods are typically higher than your winter, which
absolutely.
Is pretty typical.
Yeah.
So you're watering trees or whatever it is.
We have a above ground little pool that we have for our kids.
Okay.
And we had actually expected it to be less because we didn't fill the pool, we didn't water the backyard this summer. We were really good about the water ban too, and then we got this bill and I couldn't believe it.
I have a well and my spigot goes because I don't close it right in the winter and it freezes. And so this year I went out and fixed them both, but it can be, I understand, it doesn't take much because I can hear the well pump running, you know, kick on and
why
in
is
the house,
it right?
You know,
And it was just such a minor leak that I didn't even know it was there until I actually felt the spigot. And it wouldn't have been a problem if the inside valve hadn't failed as well. It's kind of taught us a lesson too to check the meter and the little red triangle in there. I mean,
and that's the speech that I give
I know,
to every.
Trish already gave me that speech on the phone. I was like, well, I've learned a lesson. I'm going to check this all the time. She's like, I check it every Saturday with my cup of coffee. I was like, all right, I'm on it.
I was repeating to anyone and everyone that may be watching. You need to check your water meter to make sure you're out.
Because what happens is once it leaves the street, we don't do
anything. Right, and I totally understand that. It's just something that we've kind of lived through and learned from now, and we never would have really known until something happened. So
the typical usage ran
6283.
So it was all, well, it went to 4 here, but only a little bit. Average the last 4 years. The rate that he's got is it's one of the blended ones because it's part of the one.
Okay. Yep. And it's also water only.
Yep. Another, I'm comfortable with the number that suggested. Calculated. I know Joe doesn't like to do any abatements. Joe comes from a town and
the city,
his last job, and he's like, no. They come in, I say no, and that was it. And I get that because what happens is every time we cost us money to make the water, costs us to keep all the pipes going. So if we keep telling, well, you can skip your bill
that,
and you can skip, you know,
right.
And it just it gets to be. Challenge for us, and so you know we've taken the approach trying to be as fair as possible.
Absolutely.
But you know we're hoping our
his
employees,
point of view
our administrative personnel, are keeping records so that this is your
this
time.
This is it. Yeah,
this is your
and
time.
I understand that. And
you know it blows up, and you know whatever else.
It's just that it's like leaving the heat on and then calling the oil company and saying, "Well, I left the heat on."
Yeah.
Can you know, not charge me for the oil that I used?
Break on the oil. That's basically what
it's exactly the. But at least, you know, by doing this scenario, you do cover the cost of the production and distribution.
Somewhat. I mean, our production is spread across all.
Sure.
I make a motion to abate the account of 113 Jewett Street, number 3214, in the amount of $298.33.
I would second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous.
Thank you very, very much.
It's almost half.
Yes. It helps us a lot. I really appreciate it.
All right, and thank you for watching that little red triangle.
I am. Believe me, I've learned my lesson. Thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it.
Have a good night.
Thank you. You too.
Just the fifth on the rate sheet, so these are use minus the first tier, minus the second tier, minus the third tier, minus the fourth tier. We'll go in more detail on that, but you should have that. All right, well, thank you for that. That's all the abatements we have tonight. I'll play the part of Joe Jordan now and give you an update on water and sewer. The meter replacement program, the scheduling is picking up, as we suspected, after the holidays. People are realizing they've got to get going. We've got two, sometimes three crews working in town now. We still get a few small issues with schedules and appointments, but, I mean, they're now one here, one there, and sometimes not even in the same week. So that's working out much, much better. They will be sending out the third notices for the first billing book. Basically, you know, you need to let us in or it could result in termination of water service. We need to change that meter.
So you put out a letter that says that?
They do that. And then obviously when it comes time for the actual, should it come time for termination, that would come from us. And on the billing side, it appears that any of the outstanding issues with Koozie have been resolved. We're ready to go with the billing with the new meters. In fact, we've got a data dump rater process when Trish gets back.
We're projecting that it should be easier?
Yes.
Okay. It's hard to remember today for some reason.
Easier in the fact that Trish will no longer, the processing will no longer rely on having to go back literally account by account and make those one-off, oh, that's this account, minus a zero, add a zero. The data is all the same for all the meters. And that was the rationale for the entire program, really. It was
there were like five things on that list, and this was one.
That was up near the top, though. The time from reading to billing was just astronomically long in today's terms. Should be able to done in days, not weeks. So, staff recruitments. We've made an offer for a water system operator, and we're just awaiting the response. I think they've got until early next week to accept that. We have interviews scheduled for early next week for the sewer system maintainer. As you know, we've had a series of internal promotions when we created the foreman spot. We've had a couple move up, and that's sort of, every time you do that, it leaves a vacancy. Somebody backfills that, so now the vacancy is still for a system maintainer. And we've got, I think, three interviews scheduled for Tuesday, I'm sorry. And the superintendent and I would like to request the board's approval to proceed immediately with the recruitment for a temporary part-time office administrator for the water department. And the need for that will be clearly demonstrated in just 1 minute. The position is included in the fiscal 18 budget, and any fiscal 17 funding necessary to cover that would be funded through payroll savings that resulted from Derek Young's resignation a couple of months ago. We'll be recruiting. That's the water operator position we're recruiting for. So we've got payroll savings there to pay for that.
Do we have feedback on that budget relative to the meetings that you've had?
Yes, I know. It's not a problem.
No, I just
want
to make sure all the pieces are.
So following on that,
sure they are, but I got to ask.
Following up on that staff update, I had basically Trish was admitted to the hospital yesterday. I'm not sure what's wrong, but I think she may be there for a while. What it really did is it's placed a significant burden on the remaining staff, let alone just for covering the office for the billing. But it really drives home the point of, you know, we need to have some duplicity in that office, some coverage there. Obviously, having another staff would have a greater efficiency in the meter replacement program as well, keeping up with customer service and so forth, as well as coverage for sick leave, vacations, and so forth. But she could be out for a week, two. We don't know. But the funding is there, and we would very much like to move on this because, again, it would be our hope that this person ultimately, with the right person being temporary part-time, would go to temporary full-time and maybe full-time and ultimately possibly be the replacement for Trish, who's told us she's retiring in 3 to 5 years, and given this current situation could be closer to three or less.
This is the same position we discussed in the last meeting.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely.
Do you have a candidate identified for this?
We don't, but we'd like to move quickly because we realize it's going to take some time to get the job description, get it out there, get the interviews.
Okay. Now, would you set this up that it would be possible to work, help out in wastewater or in your office or whatever it is that depends? Okay.
Yes. It basically what we did with Joanne, that position when she was here. She was not really a floater, but when needed, she could easily cover here. I think she covered at sewer.
The sticker program can be a lot of work or whatever it is. You know, there's these ebbs and flows. And
absolutely.
It's good to have somebody around to help.
And the town administrator is on board with this?
Yes.
So
I am fully in favor of it.
So go.
Okay.
I assume we don't need a vote on that.
We touched on briefly. I'm also saddened to report the passing of Chief Operator, Water Operator Bob Ash's mom passed away this week, as did his girlfriend's mother. That's a big loss for that family.
Difficult.
And Highway Foreman Mike Schrader's mom passed away this week as well after a lengthy illness. So our condolences go out to all of those families. And we're anxiously expecting the return of one of our water operators, Ryan LaPierre, who's been out for the past week with a concussion. So I would like to congratulate Adam Dufour and Dick Tampani for holding down the fort admirably while being short-staffed and then faced with these crises one after another. They've done a hell of a job. But hopefully next week will be better. I really don't know how it could get much worse.
I don't think so. it's a hard week.
And the last thing I have on that is the Groton IMA. Joe and Paul and I are meeting with the Groton Working Group tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, I believe, in Groton, discussing the IMA negotiations, the billing, and very likely the upgrades to the wastewater treatment facility. Which, by the way, the contracts, I know the town administrator signed them today. Lori was out this afternoon, and we'll get her to sign those first thing Tuesday. We actually called up and asked where they were, and they told us, well, we mailed them a week and a half. They mailed them at the end of December. Oh, okay. So the FedEx new copies over. We executed those, and when Chris went down the post office today, they were in our P.O. box. And they were post-dated December 27th or 28th. So they did mail them. Where they went, I have no idea, but not that I doubted them. So that's it on water and sewer. I just thought I'd keep that fairly brief. We still have not received the final report from Blue Leaf for the Green Sands, but again, it went very well, and other than having a discussion at some point about the oxidizing agent, I think they're going to recommend Green Sands is your solution for your iron and manganese problems at Bemis.
I would guess the weather we're having is helping us recover from our drought conditions. So
the precipitation deficit is dropping, but these cold snaps aren't helping in the fact that it's freezing the ground, and rather than absorbing, it's running off to the street, out to the wetlands, out to the rivers. But it's helping. It's certainly not hurting. I'll put it that way. And we will continue to monitor that, and we will definitely.
Yeah, it would be good to hear where we are compared to, if the well elevations should react.
They're creeping back up. That they are, and the state has been actually pretty good. Usually about once a month, they've been issuing, drought alert updates, and it's slowly but surely the red and orange zones are shrinking, so it's coming back. But people are still a little bit nervous. So moving on to just the general DPW, the fiscal 18 budgets, as you had asked about. We met with the town administrator and or the finance committee. Some didn't meet with everybody, but I met with both Mark and with the FinCom. They were the same budgets that were presented to you at the last meeting. There was no changes there. And very few items created any real discussion. Quite honestly, I think the biggest issue was surrounding the requested capital outlay of about $717,000 from Highway.
Yeah.
It got their attention, and that was the idea. And they were as interested in it as this board was, hearing about it. Some of the larger ticket items, the sweeper, the backhoe, the front-end loader, those could be targeted to be put on a larger town-wide capital plan, a bond. You know, let's what that amount will be, when it will be, you know, that's still up in the air.
And I know when we were here, they were talking about fire vehicles or something.
Exactly. Like so, and so I'm figuring it's got to be at least a seven-figure bond note for at least 20 years, and let's get some of these.
The bond vehicles for 20?
Some of the bigger ones, like the equipment, you know, the loaders, fire engines, sure. Okay. Pickup trucks, not so much. And we're certainly hoping that some of the other ones, the smaller ones, the used trucks and so forth, somehow those can be worked into the what we presume will be the next iteration of the town's, I'll call it mini capital, you know, $200,000 to $300,000 a year is what's been sort of targeted for the last couple of years. And we're hoping to get a couple of the smaller pieces on that, you know, maybe the dump truck or something like that. But there, you know, Mark is working right now with Lori, with the FinCom. He's been meeting with most of the other departments. You know, he set up meetings with the FinCom for them. The big ones, preliminarily, you know, DPW, water, sewer included in that, police and fire. We had an entire night before the FinCom. It took 4 hours to go over those budgets. It was a long night.
Yeah, it's quite a meeting.
So. We're hopeful, but again, right now I haven't heard anything back. The only change I've seen on the non-enterprise fund budgets, Mark asked if we could take the $10,000 for the NPTES consultant and move that to the capital plan. I said, that's fine, that's where it was last year. What I had been doing, just so you know, I all the NPTES-related requests, I was just trying to keep them in the engineering budget just for a convenient one-stop shopping. You know, if you needed something related to NPTES, it's probably in this budget. But last year he took it out, and this year I think he'll take it out again and put it into the capital out of free cash.
Okay.
So
it's not really capital.
It's what they're calling it, large expense. You know, it's, I mean, $10,000 is it's a one-time large expense. And as you know, we're still working on the, you know, Joe's working on the fiscal 18, you know, for water and sewer for the annual small cap items. But we have had a preliminary discussion, and I mentioned this to Johnny, but this may be a good time to bring it up with the board. I think you and I had a discussion about it too, is a potential relocation / consolidation of the water offices. And by that, there's many reasons that would be beneficial. Security considerations. I mean, right now we've got essentially one person up there, essentially by themselves all day. After the crews leave after dark, that's just not a good situation. And things such as the office coverage, coordination, and general customer service. Being people just, you know, you get lost driving out there. But, you know, due to the financial obligations that we have for the Chestnut Street facility, you know, we may need to have the crews continue there for a while, because we have a about $20,000, I don't round numbers, $20,000 till about 2028 is our obligation on that building when they floated the bond. I think it was 2006, 7, somewhere in that ballpark, maybe 2008. It was probably when they actually permanently, because the 20-year bond. It was about a $400,395-ish to do with the upgrades. The property was acquired as part of the Purple Springs, 260-some-odd acres. The building came with the land. It was vacant. It was being vandalized. At that point, the water department was in Canal Street. And so I was like, tell you what, you pay for the renovations, the building is yours. And so what they did is they sold Canal Street, used the proceeds to help offset some of that, because I saw the contract was about $400,000, so plus the sale of Canal Street to cover the interest, that makes sense. So that's where that sits financially. And so one of the thoughts we had, and take one of those, and I apologize, this was just a crude sketch that I threw together literally an hour before the meeting. I thought it might help things. But one thought we had was putting an office facility on the, are there any extras down there? Just want to make sure Sue can get one. Thank you. So one thing we talked about, you know, actually at the last meeting was expanding the property down at the wastewater treatment plant, and potentially because we believe that the adjacent properties may be coming up for sale. So what we've asked, we've tasked Wright Pierce to do with a letter report. Real rough numbers. What if we had to double the capacity at the treatment plant? I have no idea. In fact, I sincerely doubt that the pipes in the street could handle that. And given our flow rates and, you know, the tier and the water saving measures, never going to happen. We could. I wish I had Joe's. I should have printed the email. He did a really nice, really quick observation that, you know, we could do a lot of upgrades and give some to Groton and still only be knocking on the door of 85%, where DEP says you should start to think about upgrading your existing capacity. So what I did, just for grins and chuckles, is if you're looking down at the far right, you know, those are the aeration basins. I just assume those got doubled. Below that, the clarifiers, add two more. Compost shed, assuming we, you know, continue to get out of the composting business, that goes away. And so if you look at the existing, you know, the prefab structure that the office has worked out of right now, essentially a mirror image of that, and that would house water, a conference room, and the public access would then be from the front off of Lomar Park. And then ultimately, at some point in time, our goal would be to create a water and sewer combined garage facility with, you know, combined bathroom and locker room type facilities, you know, for the staffs, obviously keeping clean and dirty separate, but sharing where we can economies such as, you know, bathrooms and whatnot. So that was just, you know, kind of give you a visual. I mean, and this could be really way off base, but just kind of give you an idea of what could fit, and the fact that if you look just above the existing aeration basins, you see that property, and it's almost, if you just took the two black lines you saw and mirrored them and doubled it, that's about the size of the first 1.1-acre parcel. There's another 22 acres adjacent to that. But of particular note, you see the red and the pink areas. That's your 100 and 500-year floodplains, and they encroach significantly into the bigger parcel as well. And so that presents a significant challenge to us. Not to mention that there's just beyond that 1 acre parcel is the detention basin, a default basin where some of these street drainage from Lomar Park empties into, mm-hmm. that in essence would become our responsibility / liability. So there was just a thought of, you know, one idea, and this could be done in steps. I was talking with John, and, you know, he's got some experience with the prefab, and I would think that the office expansion could probably be done $120,000-$130,000 all in. I mean, a real simple 24-36, simple truss cape on a foundation, and you're done.
So this, just to clarify, this mm-hmm. is using current property owned?
Correct.
Okay, so it doesn't...
No own, new so, property.
Okay. The one thing that I thought of after you and I talked was by consolidating everything, right? The impact of things like power outages would be greater. By having a distributed mm-hmm. organization, you could lose power in one facility, right? And at least be able to still service.
This place has backup power.
Yes.
Oh, it does?
Oh, yes.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Massive backup generator.
And right. Any other than process type stuff, the loads from, you know, the garage is minimal.
Okay.
Wouldn't impact generator.
Yeah. Yeah.
And luckily, I mean, in this particular location, because it's in an industrial park, it tends to get restored
quickly,
much quicker than Chestnut Street.
Yep.
And Chestnut has other issues as far as, you know, the communications, the wireless, the cable. There's not even Well, there is town water. There's not a water main. It is an old service that was run cross-country from Maple Street to run the old Pepperell Springs disinfection facility. I think it's a 2-inch line. I wouldn't call it a town water.
Sure.
By any means, but so that's just kind of give you some idea of how it could be done, how it could be phased, kind of what we're thinking of. We're still very, very preliminary in our discussions, pros and cons. I think Joe was going to meet with the Morton building people. You know, that's what we'd be thinking of, like for the garage would be a steel-framed Morton building. Insulated, a few windows and garage doors. And really nothing, not Westford. We're not looking to build that. But obviously there's things to still be issues related to the potential disposition of Chestnut Street, the cost of this expansion, the impact limitations on any proposed treatment expansion. And one other thing, I mean, I just threw it in there, that there's a rather large expanse of property available between the two existing buildings, you know, the headworks and so forth. We use it for parking a couple of vehicles there. Almost all that space would be up for grabs as well. So again, it's all very, very preliminary, but I just thought, you know, at least Joe and I are thinking right now is that it's, I think it's worth exploring. Like I said, you know, Chestnut Street it's not optimal. It's certainly light years ahead of where Canal Street was. Mm-hmm. This would be new, you know, we'd sort of start that cycle again. Chestnut Street at some point will need some maintenance, although it's a concrete building. But it still has infrastructure type needs. It's also severely limited. I read through the deed restrictions on it. It's a municipal use only. Expansion at this point is limited to 10% or 500 square feet. You could go to Neshoba Conservation Trust and ask for something larger, but it would be literally an act of legislature to get that CR amended. Can't pave the parking lot. No commercial or industrial uses, no residential uses, no camping, no nothing, just municipal uses. So, you know, what could you put there? I don't know, storage for Parks and Rec, or, you know, a satellite police and fire. I would strongly think that there's no way that we're going to get let off the hook for the financial obligation for the upgrades. You know, we own those. We own that debt through 2028.
No, you're talking long term with the big expansion plan here. Is there a way to move the administration in the short term?
It would be just that the small building. I said for I'm thinking, let's round numbers, call it 150,000. That's half of the annual small cap from both budgets. I mean, we literally could do that within the fiscal 18 budget.
But I guess is there? I mean, the downstairs is why it's dry storage, I guess. And if we were more thoughtful with that area, is there a way to optimize its use?
We were thinking of that would be an excellent place because that's where all the servers and everything are for the billing and so forth. Ultimately, we'd be also mid-long term, we're looking for GIS support, and that would be an excellent place to put the GIS person. And then one other thought is that, you know, and this another pro-con consideration. Obviously, you know, Sue and I are here at Town Hall. At some point, you know, maybe our offices could be there. The idea ultimately would have been to have something like a DPW facility, let's say at, you know, Lowell Road for the highway department, and just add a bunch of garage bays with office space. That way you've got everybody but sore there. I mean, you could bring everybody on that campus. Sure. I just don't think the town's got the stomach for that. I mean, look how long police and fire have been waiting, and those usually come well before DPW facility. And they're looking at $12 million for renovating their facility. I just don't think we'll see it in our lifetime, kind of a thing. So the expansion potential for bringing everybody except highway there is fairly great. Again, it in a preliminary fashion. Sure, short term, could we put something downstairs? Yeah, I think, you know, you could finish off the downstairs.
I'm just thinking if
stud it,
given G-rocket. The challenges with, yeah, with, you know, having enough people available for customer service.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, there's one there and there's one at Chestnut Street, and we're going to have another half. Is there a way to pull them all together at one site so that somebody ends up,
yep,
sick or retires or whatever this, yep, is, and there's a lot more team?
ability.
I will say the basement space also at the existing building is limited. I mean, we've had a couple of meetings down there. It's usually kind of dark in the back corners, but that's where all of, as you said, dry storage, that's where all the plans, all the files, everything from upstairs
are kept down there. Right, but we could find alternate dry storage, mm-hmm. probably.
Move it up to Chestnut Street.
But then now you have to, I mean, eat it.
If
it's stuff that you're not seeing or, you know, if it's plans, okay, let's scan them all and, you know, archive them. You're getting an admin in. While they're not busy, they go scan, you know, sets of plans, and all of a sudden you don't need all that. You can still keep the paper, but you now have them electronic and, you know, you can open. There's just ways to move.
Yep. I think one of the big things, too, about, you know, having a separate one would be the inclusion of an appropriate conference room. I mean, right now we've got the table in front of Chris's counter. It works.
No, I...
far cry from professional, but it works. But again, just options, just thinking it through, thinking of the pricing. And again, there's a lot to consider with all the buildings, whether it be town hall, maintaining a presence here. I mean, I know I'll speak for Greg. You know, Greg Rice always thought we should have a presence here in town hall. People come in to pay their bill. There should be a DPW facility to pay a DPW bill, water, sewer, transfer station, what have you. As time goes on, things get more streamlined, electronic, online type things. You know, maybe that becomes less and less important.
Sure.
The issue with the town hall hours, you know, as it is now, is the town hall closed on Friday? Yes, it's closed to the public. It could be a strong likelihood the town hall will be closed on Fridays. Kind of leaves us hanging a little bit. I mean, I've had Sue going up working with Trish the last couple of Fridays, and luckily we've got places to go. But, you know, at some point it just might be, you know, enough. Let's consolidate. There's always greater efficiencies in the consolidation. And not to mention, I don't see either one of the operations growing exponentially. In other words, you know, by investing in something like that, are we going to outgrow it in 10 or 20 years? I don't think so. I just don't see us laying that much more water main or expanding the sewer district that much bigger. I don't see the need for doubling again kind of a thing. Otherwise, I certainly wouldn't consider something like that. I think we're fairly well dialed in for the foreseeable future. But again, just food for thought. And again, this is barely worth the printer paper it's printed on, except we use really good color ink, so that makes it worth something. But other than that, no, it's not the scale. It's all done with, you know, the draft and draw tools in GIS. It's not.
It's a concept.
It's a concept.
Yeah. It's a concept. Where's the lower property line, the southern property line, if this is north-oriented?
It is, you know, and I went back and forth. I thought it was more important to show the north one and keep the whole thing from Lomar Park to the river in here. It's just below where the color cuts off. It's within, as looking at it there, it's within a quarter inch.
Doesn't Lewis own some of it?
Yeah, he owns up to the north. That's why I wanted to show this one up here where it says
Lund. NF1.
Actually, it's not under his name, but you would recognize it. It's obviously under his holding company's name. I said, and there's actually two parcels. One is a 1.1 acre, and then there's about 22 more acres beyond that. And then beyond that is actually open space associated with the Merrimack Drive development that's under CR to the town. And I know that the rec department has been talking about that for a long time as a potential location for additional playing fields, which really aren't any in that neck of the woods.
Yeah.
So with that, we will continue to talk budgets with the FinCom. I think I hit on all the highlights and the week before. I think, you know, the big thing, once again, just a reminder, what you're going to see is under the salary and wages, the split salary personnel, myself, Sue, Peter, we're now being carried in, I call it the home budget. You'll find all of my salary in the engineering budget. You'll find all of Peter's in the highway department budget. you will not see us carried in the salaries and wages portions of transfer station or in water or in sewer. You will find us, or you'll find an amount in the indirect cost section of the...
It's an allocation.
Of the enterprise fund. So the money comes back to the general fund, and the general fund then pays the increase in the highway and engineering budget. So it's I call it a shell. It's an accounting exercise. That's probably the single biggest change. Everything else is essentially level funded. Okay. And obviously, as we hear more, you'll hear more.
When will the budget be final?
Don't know. I suspect, I would think by the end of February. Final, you know, the town budget will be, I think, be final certainly by the end of February. School budget, which has a huge impact on town budget.
Sure.
Anybody's guess. There's been years where they've gone literally to the 11th hour and we've scrambled to say, we need to cut 11.7%, you know, across the board. And you just wind up with some really weird budget numbers.
Yep.
You know, $5,000 now becomes 43, 87, 42. You know, it's, how'd that happen? But yeah, this, I know the town administrator works really hard with John Landers. And they're working actually with all three towns. And they're trying to get them to do an accurate projection of their school costs to avoid that kind of surprise.
Yep.
As well as with Neshoba Tech. And I, it sounds, and again, I'm not part of it, but it's, by all accounts, it sounds like it's being successful. And they're getting good feedback. And that certainly helps us, you know, that given that take, okay, here's what you need, and we need to adjust ours. And you just fine-tune back and forth.
Yep.
I'm hoping there's no major surprises, because, you know, the town has been operating on a shoestring for a while, and it really needs to start investing in itself. I mean, I think the capital investment from the highway is indicative of what you're seeing throughout town. We could spend money in any one of a dozen places, and it'd be a good investment. Ethics exam. There's an email from the town clerk in your packets. This is just a reminder that, you know, many of the town staff and board members are coming up on their semi-annual renewal for the ethics exam. In talking with the town clerk,
biannual, you mean?
It's every 2 years. It's not
correct.
Semi-annual.
Biannual. I will make sure I don't make that mistake in the minutes.
But you have to look. It's either, yeah. I don't know if it's biennial or biannual. It's one is every 6 months and the other is every 2 years.
So, but the clerk would like to have, regardless of whether you took it last year or you do this year, she would love to get all of the town of Pepperell on a January of 17, January of 19, get everybody on a schedule so that she sends out one email blast, everybody knows they have to do it, everybody does it.
Done. I did it like that day, so.
Yeah, so.
You did, Jeff?
Yeah.
So it's just a reminder. The email contains the information. I'm sure Bill probably got his done.
I started it one day, I got halfway through it, the phone rang, and that was it.
That was it. So, but the contact information is there if you're wondering what it is. And John, you can do with it what you see fit.
I haven't had one that come out right yet.
Actually,
the print.
You would have, as electrical inspector, you would have to take it regardless.
Yep.
Veterans Breakfast. Carmen DeFilippo, our chief wastewater operator, he's asked me to remind the board and anybody watching that the March Veterans Breakfast is fast approaching, and it's on March 11th this year. And once again, DPW, as usual, sponsors the March Breakfast. Obviously, funds are needed to provide the food, and we're seeking donations. We're suggesting $10, but anything is greatly appreciated. Anybody wishing to donate can contact Sue at Town Hall prior to March 1st. And anybody wishing to help out on the 11th should just plan to arrive at the VFW for 7:30 a.m. It's usually a pretty good breakfast, and it's a lot of fun. So, Birch Drive, 40B. I did attend the ZBA public hearing continuation last night, and the project appears to be moving towards the issuance of a comprehensive permit. There was some discussion about whether or not the ZBA has the legal authority to waive public works fees, specifically that 50% request of water and sewer connection fees that they made. The developer's attorney was confident that under the HAC, it's a state agency, housing authority something, that the ZBA does in fact have that authority, and town council was there and he appeared to agree. What I've asked is that if they could provide preferably a joint written opinion one way or the other, and I think it would be in the affirmative to have the ZBA go ahead and grant that waiver. We would appreciate that because we obviously stand ready to assist the ZBA in you know, whichever way that goes. And so I talked with a developer today, and he was actually going to have a plan to call and contact his counsel this afternoon anyway, so he's going to try to clarify that by next week.
Do we have a dollar value on that?
We did. I don't have it with me, but yes, we did.
I thought it was like, shouldn't say any numbers, but it was like 10 or 12,000 or something like that. The total between for each was the, and so they were going to pay about that much.
Right. As well as put in the infrastructure. And
correct.
Turn it over.
It was really
so
good.
I will throw this out to the board for your edification. Another word you don't hear very often. There was some mention of some of the residents last night when the issue of the 50% waiver came up, that they would be approaching the board for refund requests for the mandatory connection fees that they were hit with when the, I don't know, I guess the state denoted the riverfront as an environmentally sensitive area and required, demanded sewer be put in there and sewer hookups. I'm just kind of paraphrasing what they said, but they said they would be coming to the board for their 50% refunds, and I said, well, you can certainly file, but you know, it's got to be within 6 months of having gotten the bill, and I'm pretty sure you're about 16 years too late, but you're welcome to come in. The board would love to see you, and I don't know if anything will come of that. I think it was just mostly people just blowing
That's
off
true.
Some steam.
Yeah.
But should anything else come up, I will let you know. The developer has been very good about making the recommended revisions for the geometry of the roadway, the drainage upgrades, and bear in mind, we're just at the, I dare say, preliminary plan level for a comprehensive permit. This is, you know, I've got drainage calculations that are pretty damn good, and this is in nowhere near definitive form yet, because they still need to file the definitive plans and the definitive calculations. So they have addressed everything we've asked as far as whether it's snow storage, whether it's a gang mailbox, whether it's adding some guardrail, street signs. They've done a traffic study. They forewent the country-style drainage. It's still kind of there because there's no curbing, but they did put in catch basins and pipes and basins, you know, detention basins, so that in a weather like this, when the roadsides get snowbanks and they freeze, you still have a place for the water to go.
Now, is this going to be private road or public road?
It'll be public.
Okay.
I can't imagine they wouldn't
propose. I mean, that's part of the proper utilities in.
Yeah.
It's easier for it to be a public road.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I just going back to them, so they're going to pay to install the pipe then, I guess. No, I mean the residents that want the rebate.
Oh.
Right? Because the development is paying to put the pipe in.
I tried to explain to them as, you know, think of it as a demand fee, if you will. You know, it's there is no pipe in the ground for them to connect into. They're putting in all the new infrastructure and turning it over to us, and therefore it wouldn't be fair. And, you know, and as a business, obviously, our revenue is much more dependent on the long-term revenue generated from customer consumption and use rather than the one-time fees, and especially in the case where developers fronting the cost of the infrastructure.
Great. Okay.
So.
Sorry to go back. I just.
No, that
scratches my tickles my head.
And there was some questions about, you know, the traffic study and you know, for the record, you know, they did. They knew traffic might be an issue. They called me and they said, you know, who would you use? And I said, VHB if they're available, which is now Vanessa Inc. I mean, I guess they. Hagen and Breslin may have retired, it's no longer VHB, but it's what they do. They are traffic engineers, have always been traffic engineers, will always be traffic engineers. They're the preeminent firm here in New England. They did a great job. They did the traffic count. I mean, they went out there literally within 2 weeks' time. They did the seasonal adjustments based on the NIMCOG. I mean, they did everything they were supposed to do, and they just didn't want to hear it. And I couldn't sit there and just watch them trash a perfectly good and very valid traffic study. So I addressed those points directly last night with the ZBA. They didn't hold any water. I think the biggest, everything currently operates at level of service A, and post-development, everything except one intersection, and I think that was Plainfield at Heald, goes from an A to a B. It just barely trips over the 10-second delay, so you have to give it a B. I mean, it's...
Yeah, all right. I mean, this community is largely A, so people are lucky. I'm sure there's lots of places in Westford that you're pulling your hair out because it's an F, you know, or whatever the failing is, because there's so many of them.
Yeah, around. I mean, D is acceptable at 40 seconds, but that's getting a little bit antsy.
Drive through Groton Center, you're here in the morning.
But you're moving.
We have three intersections in design in Westford at the moment. Yep.
But, you know, actually, and I had conversations with some of the abutting residents both last night and then a couple came in today. And, you know, I think they're starting to, I don't want to say accept. I mean, they are accepting it. As one gentleman said, he goes, I still don't like it, but I understand it and I get it and it's going to happen. And, I mean, that, it's like the stages of grief. You know, you got to understand it. But, you know, the property was vacant. Somebody bought it. It had been for sale. And quite honestly, as I told them, I'm sure if somebody made an offer, the developer would be glad to give up their rights. Of course, it'll be more than what they paid for it, given what they've got into it and the potential.
Right, right.
But you can maintain that open space if sure. you've got the money. So, but it looks like it's moving towards, I think that they're doing a site walk Saturday, and I suspect they've got one more continuation, and I don't, unless there's something, a showstopper lurking out there that nobody's thought of, I can't imagine that they won't close the public hearing and then start writing the decision and the conditions. And that's where that opinion from council will really start to weigh heavy.
Okay.
That's all I have tonight. There's nothing requiring signing. Trish didn't get around to doing the commitments. And commissioner's comments. One thing I was thinking, I know the next meeting would be January 26th. Let me just throw this out. I know I will be out of the office that day. I have a personal appointment that I could probably be back for that meeting that night, but I wouldn't have a lot of time to prepare for it. Joe is could be here and is more than willing to sit down and talk to you at length about the water and sewer budgets if you want to hold that meeting. I also know that I'm planning to take off the week of January 8th, 9th, maybe it's the 7th through the 10th. That's going to be a vacation week for me.
February.
So if we met on the 26th, the next February meeting would be February 9th. And I know I'm going to be out that week on vacation. So my question is, do you want to meet 2 weeks hence, or do you want to go one more week to February 2nd and then the 16th, and then we're back on a 1st and 3rd? I mean, there's nothing really super pressing.
The only thing that I see is Joe's made any progress on the rate side. And it, as long as, because I'm guessing that we're going to want to implement these. Doesn't mean it has to be July 1, but
yep.
Typically that's when these things occur. So I just want to make sure that we have enough time to get.
Well, I know, and that's why I suggest on the 26th, you know, I know he's working on the revenue side of the water sewer budgets. But again, you know, with the rate increases we had, you know, depending on where the capital goes and, you know, something like this might have an impact.
We're talking about this for FY18?
At this point, it's, I would say no.
Okay. No, I just, this to me is a lot to put on the plate, especially where we have other more important things to take that take precedent at the plant. You know, I understand the need to try to pull people together, and I'd rather make accommodations within what we have. This just could make things a lot more complicated down there in that time period.
I'll tell you one other thought I did have too on that is having driven by it almost every day for a while, Triumph Leasing constantly has trailers for lease and or sale. You see them all the time. Schools, classrooms. I mean, you know, it was on the site for 5 years till we built a new school. Yep. What are they going to do with it?
Right.
You know,
$15,000 or whatever.
Something like that. You roll it up next to it, put a set of stairs on it. Yep. You know, wire it up for power. You've got instant office space, conference room. You know, for short money.
Yep.
So that would be something like that would be an option too, and kind of see how things work. I mean,
That to me would feel a little. I see a lot of challenges regarding this. We could talk about them at some point.
And part of me also thinks, you know, not knowing about the expansion, and you know, I'd like to see the dust settle, maybe somewhat, at least on the design end of things, on the upgrades for the wastewater plant itself. I really don't relish having competing projects going for construction space. You know, Bill, you probably know what it's like when you've got GCs banging heads with each other on site space. There's no need for it.
And again, during the upgrade, it'd be a good time to throw an addition into the office building.
That could be done, and that's why I threw the number out. And again, it's been a long time since I looked at them, but you know, I'll say that 150 number seems a good budgeting number, and again, to put that in perspective, that would be half of 1 year's small cap for both water and sewer combined. So there's 125, something like that.
Right. No, I just this will complicate things from a financial standpoint, because is this a water project? Is it a sewer project? Is it an IMA project? I think we got to talk through a lot of stuff to understand how this is how this is approached, and how is it paid for ultimately.
As I told Joe when I said, you know, I'll be glad to bring it up tonight, and I'll throw as much as I can out there.
Yeah.
But I'm sure there's a lot more questions. And in fact, I was actually thinking of that this afternoon. You know, oh great, the IMA, and do they get charged for that? Is it? And to your point, if it gets rolled into the upgrades at the plant, then yeah, the 25% of it, unless you're going to tease that piece out.
This sounds to me like a water thing, not a sewer thing. So,
right.
You know, water funds now, do we have to vote an authorization from the water side to.
Right. And water is, you know, obviously not. The financials aren't quite as robust as the sewer side. Let's put it that way, as far as like the retained earnings, with what they've gone through.
But the water rates are much lower than the sewer rates.
And
sewer rates
is,
are quite healthy, and so.
Which is why I think, you know, when Joe asked and said, "Well, we'll give you this for now and move on," and that leads to your thought about, you know, the rates. So it all plays together. And yes, I don't want to be premature. In fact, you know, the more I think about it, something like a temporary facility. I don't know if I think I'd probably prefer that over finishing off the basement, but that may be an option as well.
Sure. Temporary facility could be your dry storage, though, and if you want people in the same building, you know.
And one other thing I forgot to mention, too, it would give us also the added benefit down the road of being able to segregate the public and office staff from the hauler trucks, RVs, you know, that now would be a dedicated, using the existing entrance, you need to get to the plant or do you need to go to the offices? Because the office entrance is right here off of Lomar Park. You don't need to come in and hope that, you know, pumper truck's not coming around the corner.
Yep.
So what would be your pleasure? Does the 2nd and the 16th work?
2nd and 16th works fine for me.
Yeah, no problem.
Which one are we doing?
February 2 and 16.
Groundhog Day?
No.
So not the 26th, right?
Just turn it into one.
going to be tied up in Boston all day.
6:30 again?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Unless you can do 6.
Somebody else had a problem.
Not to get.
I don't know. 6:30. I think Joe said something about 4:30. I don't know. Yeah.
I would do that too.
And I think it goes without saying, but it certainly bears mentioning. I think the highway crews have done a great job with the storms that we've had. Nothing huge, but they've been those pesky, problematic, freezing, icing over. And, you know, what people don't tend to understand is, you know, 4 inches costs as much to move as 9 inches.
And the other night, the light rain was a tough night.
Yeah. Yes, it was, and the freeze thaw and... Absolutely, but they've been at it, and not a complaint.
They do a great job,
sir. I assume you don't have numbers on budget, but we're probably not far from being tapped at this point.
I should be getting the latest round shortly. I haven't seen the December ones. I don't recall.
I just know that there've been enough of them, you know, but that. It's not hard to go through our underfunded budget.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's for your, you know, it's $180,000 a year is the snow and ice budget, and that's about...
It's been that number for, 30 years?
Yeah. One-third, or 66,000 personnel, and whatever the balance is materials. Yeah. But it's deficit funded for a reason. Some years we blow it right out of the park. But we're usually a lot less than most of the surrounding towns, and I think we compare quite favorably.
I think you do a better job than surrounding towns.
I know we do.
I've thought that for years. So.
Any other comments, questions? No. I've got nothing that the chair could not reasonably anticipate.
I make a motion.
If you're motioning to adjourn, I will second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. At 7:48. 7:48.